Thank you so much for the introduction. I met some of you yesterday, and for the ones I didn't meet, great to meet you. And so yes, I'm Arash Davanian. I'm a glaucoma specialist in town here. And we're gonna be talking about diet and exercise and glaucoma management. So the two key things I'll focus on today are different things you can do with your lifestyle to help with blood flow to the optic nerve, which is what is damaged in glaucoma. And then other things will be things to lower your eye pressure, which is a big risk factor for glaucoma. And just a disclaimer before we go into all these things, diet and exercise studies are just inherently hard to perform. Most of them, they have a lot of confounders. A lot of the studies, especially the diet studies, are based on surveys, and you know, people sometimes lie on surveys. And none of this really replaces the glaucoma treatment recommended by your doctor. These are just adjunct things that you can do in addition to what your doctor is recommending. And these are the things we'll talk about today, and we'll get into the details of every one of them. So diet and nutrition. This is a big topic, and everybody just ate, so this is very fresh on everyone's mind. So fruits and vegetables is, they're rich in antioxidants, they're rich in nitrates. Nitrates have been shown to improve blood flow to the eye, and things like spinach, kale, collards, citrus, berries, and carrots have those antioxidants and nitrates that we're talking about. The heart-healthy diet and the Mediterranean-style diet has also been shown to improve blood flow to the optic nerve and decrease incidence of glaucoma. Antioxidants, specifically vitamins A, C, E, and the carotenoids in some of the fruits and vegetables that we just talked about, those improve blood flow to the eye as well. Then there's the big question of omega-3 fatty acids. These are things that we get from salmon, fish oil, and the results on this are mixed. So some studies show benefits, some studies don't show benefit. So it's not directly recommended just for glaucoma, but certainly if you'd like to take these, it's not gonna hurt your glaucoma. And then the other thing that studies have looked at is a low carbohydrate diet. And the study compared low carb diet to a normal carbohydrate diet, and the low carb diet did not decrease the risk. However, when there was a low carb diet paired with proteins and fats from plants, then that actually did decrease the risk of glaucoma. And hydration. So if you're adequately hydrated, you get better blood flow to the optic nerve. It's one of the concepts we're talking about. But you certainly don't want to drink large volumes of water at one time, because that can actually increase your eye pressure transiently. And there was a test that they used to do for glaucoma where it involved drinking large amounts of water and checking your eye pressure. Now we get to exercise and physical therapy. So this is something, you know, everyone can start doing. And the first one is aerobic exercise. So aerobic exercise has many, many health benefits, but specifically it's linked to improved blood flow and decreased eye pressure during exercise and for short term after exercise. And this can include things like power walking, stairs, if you're able to do stairs, a light jog, swimming, anything that gets your heart rate about, you know, to the 120 level or whatever is safe with your primary care doctor. And the recommended amount is about 150 minutes of moderate exercise a week. And that has been shown to, you know, help improve blood flow to the eye. And the intensity of the exercise that you do is actually linked to a lower eye pressure afterwards. And then resistance training. You know, resistance training, especially in some of the glaucoma population, helps many other things like skeletal muscle mass and bone density. But when you're doing it, it is linked to higher eye pressures. But it was mostly due to breath holding. So the study that looked at this, they looked at resistance training with breath holding, and then they had the patients breathe through it. And when they breathe through the resistance training, the eye pressure was actually lower compared to when they held their breath. And so just the recommendation is, yes, please do resistance training. However, practice proper breathing technique while you're doing these exercises. Yoga and inverted positions, again, another thing that has many, many other health benefits. The one thing you generally want to avoid is inverted poses because there's a rush of blood to the eye. One study showed that it actually doubled in value. And so you generally want to, it's safe to do yoga, but you'd want to avoid inverted positions for a long period. So, you know, a down dog here and there is okay, but if a quarter of your practice is inverted positions, ideally you want to avoid that. Now, body weight. So obesity specifically has been linked to higher eye pressure, likely because there's less blood flow leaving your head because of neck circumference. But specifically, higher BMI, higher, bigger waist circumference, the fat mass that you have, fat mass compared to lean body mass, have been linked to higher eye pressure. And then the things that have been linked to lower eye pressure are the things that are, you know, sound better. So greater lean body mass to weight ratio, greater skeletal muscle mass to BMI ratio, bone density compared to BMI, those have all been linked to lower eye pressure. So ideally, you know, you and this is safe for everything else in your life too, but ideally you want to keep your BMI low, and it'll help also with your eye pressure. Now this is a big one, so sleep. So sleep has, your eye pressure can go up while sleeping. Some studies show that the peak eye pressure can actually be while you're sleeping, and some other studies show that progression actually happens sometimes at night due to these factors. And so one thing we can talk about is sleeping position. So when you compare standing, sitting versus laying down, your eye pressure is higher when you're laying flat. So that's one reason why the eye pressure is a little bit higher while you're sleeping. When you're sleeping on your side, the eye that is on the down position has higher pressure than the eye that's in the upward position. And when you're face down on the pillow, that has the highest higher pressure than compared to just laying flat or laying on your side. So the recommendation is just to avoid sleeping with your eye directly on the pillow or mattress. You can use a contoured mask with a soft or a soft pillow with a cutout. If your glaucoma is asymmetric, let's say the right eye is worse than the left eye, ideally, you know, maybe sleep on your left side if you want to, if you sleep on your side. And one study showed that actually elevating the head of the bed by 20 degrees, either using a sloped pillow or a bed that can elevate, that helped lower nighttime eye pressure. So that's something else you can try doing if you're able to sleep that way. And then sleep quality and duration. So there's mixed evidence, but decreased sleep duration and poor quality have been linked to glaucoma. The recommendation is about 7 to 8 hours of on a regular schedule daily. And this is good for most things in life as well. So, you know, no one will tell you to start only sleeping 4 hours a night. So this will help other things in your life as well. Now, this is another one. So blood pressure during sleep. This specifically in people with, you know, normal tension glaucoma or low pressure glaucoma, blood pressure at night has been linked to progression. And you want to try to avoid blood pressure meds right before bed, but work with your primary care doctor, because there are some studies that show that lower blood pressure at night actually helps with other factors like, you know, your heart and stroke risk. So you want to make sure it's safe for you to do that. If you do have low blood pressure at night and you've already, you know, you already don't take blood pressure meds before bed, you can hydrate before going to bed, or consider a small snack or added salt to prevent your blood pressure from dropping at night. Another one is obstructive sleep apnea. So this is intermittent stopping of breathing during sleep that has been linked to glaucoma. But there's mixed evidence that this can actually cause glaucoma progression. So some studies do show that it causes glaucoma progression. Some studies show that it does not. But despite this, you know, there are multiple other benefits to treating sleep apnea. And so treatment is recommended with a sleep doctor if you do have it. And the easiest thing to do is just ask your partner, hey, do I snore at night? Or if you're in your doctor's office, you know, and partners with you, you know, maybe that's something you can bring up with the doctor at the time. Now, this is a big one, so stress reduction and mindfulness. Of course, we would all love to have less stress in our lives and you know, have a more mindful life. But stress can increase eye pressure and can cause worsening glaucoma by decreasing blood flow to the eye. And it's possibly related to the stress hormone, which is cortisol, which is released while you're stressed. And we all know that, you know, steroids can, in some people, increase eye pressure. And so one thing you can try to do is mindfulness meditation. So just 10 to 20 minutes a day of guided meditation or deep breathing or mindfulness practice can help lower the eye pressure and decrease inflammation. The study that really looked at this, it was a smaller study, but they found that when they meditated for about 3 weeks, an hour a day, and they found that the group that meditated for 3 weeks compared to the group that didn't had lower eye pressures, and they looked at the stress markers, and they had lower stress markers and inflammation markers. Again, limited study, small patient population, but you know, this is something else. This is something that has other benefits as well. Mindfulness exercises. So if you don't like just sitting there, you know, and meditating, these are things that are have similar benefits. So yoga nidra, which is just yoga sleep. Shavasana is the final relaxation part of yoga. Pranayama is a breathing exercise. Tai chi or qigong. They're forms of guided movements that can help keep you focused and help with the mindfulness meditation part. And then another thing is biofeedback. It's consciously reducing muscle tension, relaxing your face muscles, relaxing other muscles to help with the mindfulness exercises. Now, these are the sins. So smoking, alcohol, and caffeine use. You know, nowadays, the media's out there, you know, no one's going to tell you to start smoking, but smoking in general is bad for your blood vessel health. It can compromise your blood flow. It has been linked to higher eye pressure, and the more you smoke, the higher the pressure can be. And the more you smoke, the worse the glaucoma can be. So just in general, you know, don't start smoking, and if you smoke, I'm sure you're working on your way to stop. Alcohol is another one. So alcohol intake has actually been linked to lower eye pressures, and red wine in moderation, because red wine contains an antioxidant. The resveratrol is an antioxidant, but it has been linked to lower risk of glaucoma. So it's okay for a glass a night, but excessive alcohol intake has a lot of other bad effects. You know, it can affect your liver, it can affect many parts of your life. It's not conducive to life, so you want to avoid excessive alcohol intake. Caffeine's another big one. I get this question all the time. You know, doc, he drinks 5 or 6 cups of coffee a day. Is it bad for him? So eye pressure can increase for a couple hours after coffee by about 1 to 2 points. And caffeine has been shown to increase eye fluid production in lab studies. One cup a day is likely okay, but more than five, you know, you can imagine your eye pressure is elevated for five multiple time points for a couple hours each day, and it can increase the eye pressure, and you want to maybe avoid it if you have advanced glaucoma with that is sensitive to those pressure fluctuations. And most studies have not shown an association with glaucoma and caffeine. So the first part, we just talked about eye pressure. The second part, you know, just the optic nerve damage. So most studies have not shown an association with glaucoma and caffeine outside of the pressure increase. And if you really need caffeine, tea has a lower caffeine content and is generally safe. And one study even looked at tea drinkers and found that they had a lower odds of glaucoma compared to non-tea drinkers. Other substances, I'll just touch on this, vaping. They haven't looked at it in detail, but there's a small risk of elevated eye pressure and blood vessel damage similar to smoking. And alternative remedies, so these are other things we get questions about. So general vitamins, there was a big study when they looked at macular degeneration, they looked at all the vitamins and saw which one was helpful in macular degeneration. And they also looked at glaucoma, and they found that there was no benefit for the glaucoma patients in just taking those vitamins. If there is a known deficiency, then certainly it can be helpful, but just taking vitamins without a deficiency has not been shown to improve glaucoma. Vitamin B3 is one that they looked at. And it has been shown to have protective benefits. And this is one that if you do have a deficiency, you want to replace it if there is one. But if there's no deficiency, there's not a lot of evidence that shows that it will help your glaucoma. Ginkgo biloba, this is an herb extracted from the maidenhair tree. It's been shown to have antioxidant effects, and it's been shown to improve blood flow. There was a study that showed, again, smaller study, take all this with a grain of salt, but smaller study that showed that it actually stabilized slash improved the visual field in some patients when they took this. And it's a possible protective effect independent of eye pressure. It can act as a blood thinner. And so if you're on a blood thinner already, please be careful taking this. Saffron is another one. It's a spice from the crocus flower that contains carotenoids. It can have an antioxidant effect, and it's been shown to lower eye pressure. The study that looked at this gave patients about 30 grams a day of saffron versus none, and the eye pressure lowered by about 3 to 4 points. And then when they stopped the saffron, the eye pressure went back up. And so this is something else that you could try using. Again, at high doses, it can act as a blood thinner, and it can cause low blood pressure. So please be careful if you're already taking blood pressure meds or you're already on blood thinners. Cannabis, marijuana, this is something we get asked about all the time. So it does lower your eye pressure by about a quarter and for 3 to 4 hours after use. But the amount you need to lower your blood pressure or your eye pressure is high, and you need to maintain that amount in your system the whole time. And so, most people will say it's just not practical to daily life to do this. And then at some point you will sleep, and then you're not using it, and your eye pressure can go up during sleep, which will already be elevated anyways. And then also lower blood pressure while using marijuana can cause damage to the optic nerve. So generally not recommended due to these factors, and it does not replace drops or surgery. Other herbal remedies, so bilberry is a berry that's been on social media a lot. It's known for its antioxidant effects. It doesn't have a lot of proof for glaucoma. Forskolin can possibly lower eye pressure. Again, not a lot of proof for glaucoma. And then curcumin is in turmeric. It has possible anti-inflammatory effects, but again, not yet studied for glaucoma. And then acupuncture is another one. It has been shown to lower eye pressure and improve blood flow. The study that looked at this was a smaller study, and there's limited evidence, and the patients really saw benefit after 4 treatments for about 1 to 2 points. But it was a reduction compared to the placebo group. And generally, it's related to improved blood flow and relaxation, the eye pressure lowering. And generally safe if done by a licensed professional. Again, it does not replace traditional glaucoma therapy, but certainly safe to use as an adjunct if done by a licensed professional. So easy things you can just start doing today, even. Power walking for just 20 minutes a day. Just go outside. It's hot right now, but at night times or in the mornings, you can go walk outside for 20 minutes a day. A mindfulness meditation practice, if you don't have one yet, consider starting one for about, the study did an hour, but even if you start 20 minutes a day and work your way up, that's something you can start doing today. Work with your primary care doctor, see if there's any vitamin deficiencies, especially in B3, and if you do have one, consider doing a replacement if it is present. And then just better sleep habits, to aim for 7 to 8 hours a night. Consider sleeping in a different position. If your glaucoma is asymmetric, or if you have back glaucoma in general, consider elevating the head of the bed. And these are just easy things you can just start doing today. And they're good for your other parts of your body too. They're just good for life in general. And that's it. These are my references, and we'll take questions later. Thank you, everyone.